Hey, welcome. Thank you for joining us for another Parent Friday. I'm here with Stephanie Smith. I'm super excited for today's conversation. I love these moments because it's given me an opportunity just to talk with some amazing people and learn more. So I'm excited today. We have a family and marriage therapist, Stephanie Smith, with us here today. I feel like I kind of have to up my professionality here a little bit. Like this is a big moment for the Parent Friday spot, but not really. But I guess just starting with, I know you, your kids come to our youth ministry and I'm huge fans of, they're so awesome and, possibly the nicest students in the world. I'm not totally sure, but possibly. And do you want to just tell us a little bit about you, your family and what you do?
Yeah. So I am a licensed marriage and family therapist and I've been providing counseling for about probably 15 years or so. And in that, I've provided counseling for just a lot of different situations, inpatient, outpatient settings. I work with families, I work with couples, I work with young kids, I work with a lot of youth. So I would say I'm kind of a generalist, but if I had a specialty, it's probably like adolescent girls. I see a lot of adolescent girls in my practice, and I work a lot with anxiety. So those are two things that have come up a lot. I've been married for 16 years to my husband, Tegan. Just had our 16th anniversary in quarantine. So That's one to remember.
Big celebration.
And then we have our two girls, ages 14 and actually almost 13. So yeah, two teenagers that we got. And yeah, they're great. Good girls, but hitting the teenage years too.
Yeah, absolutely. I can only imagine. And so what have you seen? I mean, I guess from your professional experience, your own family experience, whatever angle you kind of want to take, but what are you seeing during this time, people at home, doing school at home, families spending more time together, good or bad sometimes? How do you see kind of COVID affecting families and what you do?
Yeah, it is such a unique time that we're in. And I keep saying like there's not been another time in my lifetime that we could compare this to. Mm-hmm. And so I think what we're dealing with is really like, it's been this sense of like a global crisis. And, usually when we deal with a crisis, it happens, it kind of peaks and then it recovers. Yeah. And in this situation, we have more of a chronic situation. And so it's a different kind of stress to be dealing with. And I think initially people were kind of, there was this energy about, okay, we're going to do the stay at home thing and we have energy to put forward to that and we can adapt. And so initial anxiety, but then there was a period of time where I really saw people adjusting and kind of like rolling with it for a while. Yeah. And then I think in the last few weeks, especially as there's been conversation about what does it look like to start reopening and what's the next step going to be? I think that anxiety is rising up again as there's more uncertainty. We don't know how long it's going to take. We don't know what that's going to look like. And I think everybody, every person has to decide for themselves sort of like what level of caution to take, what level of fear is reasonable and what level of caution and fear is just too much. And I think that's a really hard question to answer when we've never been through something like this before.
Yeah, especially when you don't totally, I mean, we get ideas when the next phase is and that kind of stuff. But like you were talking about, we don't necessarily know when it's going to end. And it kind of seems like the stages of grief. I know it's a little bit different, but really grieving the loss of so much. What do you think with young people? How does that play into young people?
Yeah, I have been having a lot of conversations about grief with my young people and with the adults that I work with as well, because it does very much parallel the stages of grief. Mm-hmm. We're not dealing with like a family member being sick. Most of us aren't dealing with it that personally, but what we are dealing with, especially our young people, are losses of what they expected this time of year to look like. Mm-hmm. And especially those grades, those fifth graders, eighth graders, those high school seniors are going through what should be kind of our cultural rites of passage. Mm-hmm. You know, there's special things that happen in those years in school and they're not really able to make that up. And so I think schools are doing a really good job trying to provide some alternative options, But our fifth graders are, you know, they look forward to CISPIS outdoor camp. They look forward to like the fifth grade graduation. Mm-hmm. Our eighth graders, so many of them get, you know, do that eighth grade graduation or a trip to Wild Waves. And none of those things are happening this year. And of course, everybody knows our high school seniors are having just an unheard of experience through their senior year right now. So I think what we really need to do is frame all of that as a loss and think of it like we do with grieving. And so it would be normal, you know, some of those grief and loss stages have to do with anger, you know, so if we're more irritable, that makes sense. If we are just more emotional or sad and we're not sure why, that makes sense. You know, there's the bargaining stage of if, what about this? If only this, if we could do it this way, then maybe that could work. You know, all of that is part of the grieving and a really normal thing to be experiencing right now.
It's such a hard thing. Thinking about, I mean, you consistently hear about the raising levels of anxiety and depression with young people, and then you hit something like this, which is just, I mean, probably makes it even worse and stuff. But it's also kind of a helpless feeling, I imagine, as a parent, just seeing love people that I know go through it. It's kind of a helpless feeling sometimes because you're there to encourage them, you want to support them, but sometimes our words don't seem to be enough to really help a young person. What, from a parent's perspective, what are some of the things a parent can do if they notice their kids feeling exceptionally anxious or just depressed?
Yeah. One of the things that I think as parents that we tend to do is we try to jump to that problem solving or that reassurance. Everything's going to be okay. Everything will be fine. Just hang in there. It'll get better. And what I think our teens need a lot of is for you to just validate and sit with them with it for a little while. Yes, this is really hard. Yes, it's hard to not know when things are going to get back to normal. It's hard to not be able to see our friends. You know, really doing, like, before we jump to that problem solving, spending that time to really acknowledge how they're feeling and just validating that it's okay to be feeling the way that they're feeling. And then we can start working on what to do about it. And I think as parents, sometimes we forget to like let them just sit with the emotion first. And we just want to like kind of move through it a little bit too fast.
What happens to, I mean, not just the young person, but any of us, if we rush somebody through those stages of grief too fast? What, I mean, what are some of the, that's probably kind of a loaded question, but what does that result in?
Well, I always think, you know, if you're talking to somebody about how you feel and they say, okay, it'll be okay, let's just move forward. It actually is pretty invalidating. And it doesn't feel like they get it. It doesn't feel like they heard you. And so that's why validation is so important. It doesn't necessarily mean that you agree with them, but being able to make space for them to just feel the way that they feel and let that have a minute really helps before you start to go to that next conversation. And so with grief, it's messy. You know, grieving, I think we like to imagine that it's like step one, step two, step three, and we just keep moving forward. It's really more like this, you know, and you go back and forth through those stages and you think you got through the anger stage and the next thing you know, you're angry again. And so it's really more of a spiral and a flexible continuum. And so I think what parents might be likely to notice are, you know, in younger kids, it might be like, you know, more kind of meltdown, tantrum, emotional kinds of moments that feel like they come out of the blue. And it's because things are building. And with our teenagers, it might be like, you know, just a little bit more, they don't seem like themselves, or they're a little bit more down, or they're a little bit crankier than usual, or, you know, or they're just tearful. And it can often feel like it comes out of nowhere. And that's a good indicator that, hey, they may be, this may be hitting them a little harder than we realized it was hitting them, and they need some support.
That's so huge. That's so crazy. Even just being a youth pastor, I don't have kids, you know, but I mean, just being a youth pastor, thinking of those different life stages, middle school to high school, and that's so true. COVID or not, that just different life stages causes us to respond to grief in different ways. So those are awesome. There's so much we could talk about. I would love to, and we kind of talked a little about this before, do like a two or three part on, I mean, really for parents, what are some things we can do as families to really help our kids with all these things? So I guess kind of final question. So I'd look forward to, I'd love to do, have a couple more of these, but kind of a final conversation of what's maybe your biggest piece of advice for families right now? You've already given some, but what would you just say? What would you leave parents with?
Yeah, you know, the biggest thing I would say right now, especially for our teens, is not to underestimate their social needs. Okay. And you know, I've got the two girls. One, we've been joking, she's living her best life. She's pretty introverted and she's totally cool right now. The other one, this social thing's a big deal for her. And so I think you really need to take a look at knowing your kid. And, you know, I know we've reached a point where it was like, okay, we need to figure out a creative way to get some live social FaceTime with the bestie because she needed it. And so, you know, I would just say, look at what are the creative ways that we can provide them that support. And teens get a lot of their support from their friends and their peer group. And doing it virtually is just not the same. Right. And so if there's a safe way where everybody feels comfortable, you know, figure that out and see what you can do about that. Then providing a little bit of structure, obviously some flexibility because things are not normal, but a little bit of structure around their routine throughout the week, having something to look forward to, something that shakes it up so it's not so monotonous, things like that are really helpful as well.
Yeah, that's awesome. I'm going to go home and apply all of that to myself. but that's awesome. Thank you so much for taking the time. I think that's super helpful to a lot of people. And yeah, look forward to talking more. Thank you so much for joining us. If anybody is watching this and maybe you have some questions, feel free to drop it in the comments or send me a message for future conversations. We'd love to hear from you and answer the questions that you might be having at home. So yeah, thank you again, Stephanie, for joining us today.
Thank you. Absolutely.